at the Impala there.
There's yesterday.
It's got to be any day. It happened yesterday. Did you see it yesterday? Genre got the wood. Our cameramen are winning the bets. Wonder if he's somewhere here. That would be
good morning, and I'm sure a few of you are wondering what happened to me yesterday. Well, Vim and I went down to Cheetah Plains, and we didn't see them, but I think it was processionary moths, or the caterpillars of, managed to fall into my shirt. Now, you'll notice I'm not wearing a normal sort of big bush shirt today, and it's because my skin is quite raw underneath, and what happened was, in about a minute and a half, and I came up in this mass of welts and bumps. There's still some left on my arm, and when I put on a bush shirt this morning, it started flaring up again, but this isn't so bad. It was so itchy and burny that I even used a silver cluster leaf bark to scratch my back. So I had to drive back from Cheetah Plains not touching anything like this with my shirt off, just so it seemed anytime I touched a rough fabric, it kicked up the itch and the burn again. So fortunately, I'm wearing a t-shirt today, and at least it's a dark brown t-shirt. And there we go. Sorry, final control is talking to me. Copy that, Rebecca. Now, on this shirt, because it's a shirt that doesn't have any obvious brandings, etc., which we don't wear, you see, it's got the one animal we're not going to see on safari today. See, there we go, a big silverback mountain gorilla. Of course, I did get this while I was in Rwanda. It's quite difficult to find shirts with gorillas in South Africa since we don't have them. Okay, we're gonna go head towards Gallego Shortcut and see if the Nkuhumas are about. Hello, Impalalas. Any babies yet? No little babies yet. That's some very pregnant females. I'm sure some of you out there have had those unbearable itches, and I had an unbearable itch stretching from the back of my neck all the way down my side and over basically 50% of my upper body. It was thoroughly unpleasant, I can guarantee you that. I wonder if the lions have moved overnight or they're in the same spot.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to the middle of the African bush for this glorious pre-dawn wonderful spot. I'm looking for lions. I got vultures in the tree. Hopefully we're gonna find them. This is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
One.
Night Safari. My name is Brent Smith. I have eggs. Eggbert, Eggsy, Zunder, the bald egg. Anything I've forgotten there, Zunder?
The Commander Egg
on camera with me today. Now, we've made our way towards where the Nkumas last were yesterday. I can hear a Franklin alarm calling off there, but the Nkumas were just down here. We can see there's some vultures in the tree. I know Byron thought there might be a carcass around, so we're going to meander into the block here, see if they were close to where they're sleeping or if they've moved off. If they've moved off, we'll start tracking. And the first place we'll check is where that Franklin is sounding very upset. But let's go check the last position first. Remember, this is 100% live. And, there we go, putting into four-wheel drive. And you can ask us questions by sending us an email to questions@wildearth.tv or use Twitter and just pop the hashtag Safari Live there. Now, for those of you who missed the pre-show and wondering where I was on yesterday's sunset safari, I had a run-in with a very evil hoho. Now, a hoho is a South Africanism, or a very sort of colloquial South African for a bug or caterpillar or any creepy crawly. Now, I'm guessing just from the way my body reacted that it was processionary moth larvae that caused it, but it must have fallen down the back of my shirt. Maybe the aerial hit a branch that dropped things down, and literally in a matter of seconds my whole body was covered in massive red burny welts. Now, there's quite a few vultures here. This is where the lions were sleeping yesterday. I just want to have a further look around to see if they're not still close by before we start trekking far and wide. Where am I? There are my, in Afrikaans, my verkijkers. So for those of you Dutch, German might understand that, and that is the Afrikaans word for binoculars. It means my far lookers. What was I looking at there? I'm pretty sure it's a stick, but it is a stick indeed. And you can see there's some more vultures in the tree there. Just have a careful squiz around. Come on, Nkumas, where are you hiding? They might have headed down towards the Gallagher pan for a little drink. Oh, there we go. Jamie is trying to get hold of me. No, I've lost my radio. And there it is. Standing by. Oh, I can smell something dead. Copy. I smell something expired. I smell rotting flesh. I think it's coming from this general area. Now, the lions have not been moving very far at the moment. Excuse me one second. Morning, Rex. One station following up on the Nkumas. They're not in the last position as yesterday, but there's still a lot of Makoti up in the trees, so I'm just having a quick look in the block. Now, definitely something expired. There's a vulture sitting low there. Always a good spot to check. Now, if there was something expired that the lions had abandoned and already opened, these vultures would have descended to the ground. Oh, look at that. That's quite pretty. Lovely light on the vulture. Oh. And since I, maybe if we don't try beat our bird record, we'll beat it. So there we go, first bird of the morning is a white-backed vulture. Ah, eggs. Come across to the dead knob thorn tree. And you see up there is a beautiful bird, that one there. That is a purple roller. And also, I'm just sitting quietly. I'm hoping to hear the noise of lions feeding, possibly the cubs calling to their mothers as well. Lovely, lovely early morning light on that purple roller. Okay. Let's have a quick look a little bit closer to the edge of the dry riverbed here, where we think the smell of death and decay is coming from. Now the lions are sleeping just up there, but this is a particularly thick area. Okay, so while Eggs and I follow our nose towards whatever could be dead, let's go say a good morning to Jamie.
And a very good morning to all of you, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. Sounds as though Brent's got a rather smelly plan for his morning. I'm going to be avoiding death, I think, and see whether or not we can't find the Queen of Juma Karula. This morning, I have Jandre on camera with me. Those of you who are watching the pre-show show will know that he has put a song in my head. I'm going to try and get this roller. It was just displaying, and I'm hoping that might mean that it has a nest somewhere just around here. Ooh, that's going to be very beautiful. Hello, lilac-breasted roller. So all in all, over the last few weeks, I have failed in seeing the first woodlands kingfisher. I have not yet seen the first chameleon, or I haven't seen the first chameleon, so I feel as though I could at least see the first European roller, or at least put the first European roller on camera. I feel like I've failed in all of the seasons first. I haven't seen any. I wasn't the first to see the cuckoos. There is dissension in the ranks. Rebecca says nobody has seen a woodland camera on woodlands. Fisher? King? Nobody has put a woodlands kingfisher on camera yet. Chandra, you're saying no. This is a vast untruth. Rebecca, what's happening here? Who is telling the truth and who is not? Oh, goodness gracious. There's much. Chandra, did you get it live or did you just put it on camera?
No, it was live. It wasn't a great shot.
It was live and it wasn't a great shot. So it could have been a... Okay. All right. We're going to cease the argument that's occurring between Chandra and Rebecca, and we'll just put one on camera today. And welcome to Jonathan S, and a very good morning to you. While our bird screeches away, they really do have the ugliest call for one of the prettiest birds. You wanted to know whether or not are you going to roll for us? No, it's going to vanish into the tree. You wanted... Yes, I know. I'm sorry, Jandre. I'll try go forward. Wanted to know if there's a difference between a purple roller and a lilac-breasted... Whoop! What's going on? Let's go forward a little bit. Why is it chasing a drongo? No, it's chasing a starling. They're such aggressive little birds. What is this all about? Now where have you gone?
Roll back a bit.
Yes, I hear. Okay. And Jonathan, The biggest, one of the biggest differences between the two birds, when you're looking, let's say you're looking into the light and you can't see the color differences. One of the big differences is to look for those tail streamers on a lilac-breasted roller. They are much more pronounced than they are on the purple roller. Now, if I'm not very much mistaken, I think that a lilac-breasted roller is slightly smaller than a purple roller, but give me 1 second and I'll just double check exactly what their sizes are. They might be quite close to each other. Is he still there? Well, that's not the best view, is it? Shall I try to get us the better view? Yes, Chandra says yes, please. I would roll back a bit if backwards was downhill. As it, there we go. So have a look at those long tails on the roller, or the lilac-breasted roller. And I'll show you exactly what we mean. So we don't really see racket-tailed rollers here, which are ones that might have slightly more visible tail streamers. And we also do not have Abyssinian rollers because, well, we're not anywhere near Abyssinia, which is far up towards the sort of more northern, north-central parts of Africa. I'm just checking up size. Give me 1 second. Purple roller, 34 to 38 centimeters. Lilac-breasted roller, 29 centimeters. Ha! 37 including tail streamers. So yes, there's a difference in body size between the two birds. Personally, I find that the lilac-breasted rollers are slightly more beautiful, but they are more common. So we do see them more frequently. And the purple rollers, if the sun catches them exactly right, they really are stunningly beautiful. But it's very seldom that the light really does do them full justice. Whereas lilac-breasted rollers, even on a cloudy, low-light day, one cannot fail but to appreciate their beauty. Oh, he's so cross. Why were you chasing a starling? You must have a nest here somewhere. Drongos and rollers tend to be among some of the most aggressive of the smaller to medium-sized birds. Whenever you watch birds mobbing something like an eagle or a harrier hawk, the charge is usually led by rollers and drongos. Yes. Chirp. Definitely not the most beautiful call of the bush, but one of the most beautiful birds. I was hoping, because a little bit earlier it did it, I was hoping he might, and I'm thinking it's a he, just by the level of aggression that he's showing, and also because there's a good chance that the females are currently incubating eggs. We're not far from that nest that Brian and myself found a while ago, totally by accident. We were watching a lilac-breasted roller, and the female's head popped out. What was cool about that sighting was she popped out and then swapped places with him, or vice versa. I don't know which one was which sex, but they swapped places, so they obviously take turns incubating eggs. Right, just quickly to finish off with a question on purple rollers. This is our purple roller. You can see, I wouldn't call it a drab. If you've seen it in the sun, it's not a drab bird, but it is one of the larger of... Oh, it's the largest, actually. Just reading the description, it is the largest of the rollers. So there are... They are relatively beautiful. They're not quite as beautiful as the, what's it called, lilac-breasted roller. We're waiting for the European rollers to make a return. This roller is one of the most beautiful. Brent saw one and I'm very jealous. I used to see them all the time where I worked before this. It's called a broad-billed roller and they are truly magnificent birds. Right, just to compare it to the lilac-breasted roller, do a quick turn of the page. Here's our lilac-breasted roller. It's definitely got more colours, I would say. It's got a vast number of various blues, greens, purples, and lilacs. Ah, Jay, you want to know if the roller, I think we're done with this for now, we'll look at European rollers if we get there, if a lilac-breasted roller is the most beautiful, most colourful bird in the Kruger. Now that is a matter up for debate, is it not? Certainly it's got one of the most numbers of colours, just to go with a really sort of spiderweb, a very basic definition of colourful. It's got some of the most colours of any bird. Is it the most beautiful? That's in the eye of the beholder, isn't it? Personally, I like rollers, but I find things like Warburg's eagles, and he's completely banned. No, Jean-Ré shaking his head. No view. No view of the roller. I like them, but I think there are other more beautiful birds. Harrier hawks, perhaps. The woodland that apparently was seen yesterday that is a matter of much hot debate. And of course you do get a lot of different coloured birds. The oriole is really truly beautiful, but it is just yellow and black, or at least the black-headed version. I'm opening that question up to the floor, to all of you. What do you think is the most beautiful bird? Not the most colourful, because I think the lilac-breasted roller probably wins that competition, but which one is the most beautiful in your opinion of the birds that you have seen on Safari Live? And you can send that through on Safari Live, hashtag Safari Live, on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv, and let's see which birds you find to be the most beautiful. I'm sure that Brent will have an opinion on this particular subject. Let's jump on board with him and find out what he thinks.
Now, Jamie just mentioned a harrier hawk. It's disappeared by being mobbed by a mass of drongos. Now, I'm just checking for the lion track still. So they were sleeping on the road, but it doesn't look like they went to the north. I wonder if they crossed straight across the road. What on earth was that? No. I'm wondering if they crossed straight across the road towards where we heard that Franklin alarm calling. Now, I'll show you now how I know where the lions were. Okay. Can see all this. All these sort of movements on the ground. That's from where the lions have been lying. You can see where the tail's been swinging. So they've been all around here, and I'm just trying to see if I can get one track going in one particular direction. The track's going all over the place. Of course, they were sleeping here during the night. Straight through there towards where that Franklin was alarming. So maybe that Franklin was alarming at the lions. Let's keep moving. Now, we're going to birdwatch, but we're going to inadvertently birdwatch while we look for lions. Maybe that is the key to breaking the record. Oh, let's just show that. Who's ready for a screen shot? Get ready. Eggsy zooming in. It's a vulture silhouette. Doom. There we go. Who's a little bit further out? I'm going to come out a little bit. So I'm going to show you where. Whoop, stop. A little bit in. And stop. A little bit to the left. Stop. A little bit to the right. Boom. There. That's if I was taking a picture, that's how I would. Oh, and he's popped his head up. How perfect. Get those screenshots in. Share them on our Facebook page or share them on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. A vulture sunrise. It sounds like a really nasty cocktail. What do you think, Eggs? A vulture sunrise. I think there's definitely a raw egg in a vulture sunrise. But there we go, a beautiful sight. Oh, now we are going to go follow those lion tracks, but I've seen another track that is quite a good one. So before we follow those lion tracks, I want you to look at this track here. You see it there, Eggs? Another one there. These little dimples almost in the ground. Now I wonder who's feeling like they're a tracker this morning? And if you can tell me what these tracks are, I'll be incredibly impressed. So if you know what those tracks are, let me know. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Now, maybe give them one last look. What do you think, Eggs? Just in case. So let's have one last look at the tracks before we move on. So there we go. You can see the little line there. That's the track I'm referring to. They've wandered all around here overnight, which tells you they normally only come out at night. Okay. Come on, kitty cats. Now, I spotted those Inkahumas yesterday before, in between drive. Now, I know there's probably a lot of you still wondering about Tingana and Shaluva and what exactly happened there. Now, Jamie and myself were lucky enough to go with Mike from Panthera to go have a look at what was going on in that spot. Now, we had a long chat about what we think happened, and of course this is pure speculation, but Jamie, Mike and myself are in agreement about what happened there. I think she was resting on a dam wall, and Tingana came in, and we think that he thought she might be a male. So he's had fights with Gajima and Mvula in that area. So I think on that sort of assumption, he just sort of almost assumed that it was a male, and he charged in. Now, he bit her first time on the back of the neck and did some serious damage. And you can actually see where the canines have gone in. His second bite. Oh, baby Impala! Yay, the first one! Let's go forward a little bit. That's the first baby Impala. That's a good omen for today. Let's try get another view of them. Got him through the gap. There he is. Hello, little one. That is the first baby Impala of the season. Probably born overnight. Let me just try to find a gap through there. Sticking close to mom. Oh, so cute. Their legs always look too long for their bodies. Oh, into the gap. Absolutely wonderful. Now, we're not going to sort of run around there too much. Mothers can be quite nervous in that first couple of hours after birth. Oh no, he's coming to look at us. There we go. Hello, sweetness. So that's the first. Look at the legs, almost look wobbly. It's incredible, they're able to run in a matter of minutes. Where are you off to, Mr. or Mrs.? I can't really see just yet. Look at that eye just peeping through the bush. Oh, that was wonderful. Well, that's a good omen for today. I'd be happy if we don't find the lions. We got to see the first baby impala of the season. Now, once the first one drops, then they start coming fast and furiously. see, is there more than one in this group? Doesn't look like it. Looks like just one. Oh, it's going behind the termite mound. Okay. Well, I am very excited. Hopefully we'll be seeing quite a few more of them. Okay, so no lion tracks there. The lion tracks were heading sort of up towards this general area. So I'm just going to check that they haven't crossed the road. If they haven't, it means the lions are in these thickets here somewhere to my north. Well, I know I'm being a bit smug, but that's 2 years in a row, first baby impala. Now for that woodlands kingfisher. I think Scott got the first woodlands last year. Still missing first woodlands, first pygmy kingfisher, carmine bee eater. So there's a couple of firsts still to get. First baby warthog, first baby wildebeest. First baby impala in Karula's jaws. No, of course I'm joking, but that's probably going to happen during this time of the year. Once the babies have been born, the leopards really focus in on eating baby impalas. Linda's wondering who won the bet on the first baby impala date. No one, Linda, we were all wrong. 22nd is quite late. Normally it's around the 10th or 12th. So no one got the bet, but it could have been because of the drought. It might have been some stillborns earlier on. But normally you get one or two or three around that sort of between 10th and 15th. And then from this 20th onwards, the rest of them start dropping. Okay, interesting. We're looking for lion tracks and we've got leopard tracks. Male leopard tracks, probably Tingana. Oh, I was telling you about them. Good thing the tracks were there to remind me. So we went to go take some skin and hair samples from Shiluva, and oh, everything's happening. The gymnogene's up ahead being bombarded. I'm gonna try to catch up with it. Oh, it's been bombarded by lots of, let's go. Hold on. Oh, now we've got lion tracks as well. I'm gonna come back to them. Let's go see what those birds are busy chasing an African harrier hawk. Let's see where the harrier hawk escape. Tingana is still here, marching along. Okay, well, I think that the harrier hawk's got away. But so basically what happened from what we can see, and as I said, the three of us think I think the fact that he probably thought she was a male, and because he's had so many fights in that area, he just immediately rushed in and bit her. And I said the second bite went through her cranium, straight into her brain, so she would not have been alive for very long. Now, he's then fed off only the internal organs when we were there, where we had a look. He hadn't fed off the rest of the body. Okay, no tracks here now. Just hyena tracks, but let's have a look a bit further on. So that's the story so far, and I don't know, it's just one of those incredible things that you, not very often does something like that happen. Male leopard killing male leopard accounts for 70% of male leopard mortalities. So, but male killing female, and outside of it being a cub, it is quite unusual. Well, let's see if we can catch up with Tingana today and see if we find his tracks again. He might have cut through towards Impala Plains. I'll just update the rest of the Rexon and Jamie and whoever else is out. So, Nkonzo of Winona Ingwe heading west on Vuyatela Access. I'm following up. There's also Ngala Nkonzo on Vuyatela Access, halfway between Aubrey's and Gallagher Shortcut. I'm not following up on that yet. Okay, so Tingana quite often likes to do this route. He did feed on the internal organs. Copy, Rex. Sorry, Michael was wondering why he fed on her. Now, and says in lions sometimes can be a sign of dominance. Well, Michael, I think he was very hungry, and out here meat is meat at the end of the day. And It's not that uncommon for cannibalism in predators, whether it be lion on lion or leopard on leopard or hyena on hyena from time to time. So it isn't that unusual, but I suppose it's not normal, but it's not unusual, if that makes any sense. And these animals can do incredible things and things you'd never expect them to do. Okay, so I just want to check up along this soft sand here. Let's see if there's any tracks up here, otherwise we're going to go check Impala Road. Morning, Steph. And Steph says, do we know which Shaluva it is? It sounds like there's a lot of confusion over this. Steph, it's Shaluva 2005. And so she was 11 year old female, not the younger one. I haven't seen the younger one in a long time. I think out of all the presenters, I've seen the most leopards, just under 30 different individual leopards in this area. And that's the one of the leopards that I have not seen. And Jamie has seen her, Viam has seen her. But the first time I got to see that leopard, she was unfortunately expired. And but no tracks here. I'm gonna have to do a swing about, go check Impala Road, and while we do that, let's see how Jamie's. Oh no, we were going to Jamie. Jamie's got a gremlin, so we're staying with me. So let's just listen for a second, see if there are any alarm calls. Just the lovely liquid call of a white-browed scrub robin. Egyptian goose flying up high somewhere. Well, you get to join me in my swing around. Oof, that's gonna be a scorcher today. And we... Hang on. Oh no. Hyena. Yeah. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go back to the last track, just confirm that it's heading to the west. I think it might get close on 100 degrees Fahrenheit today. Started off really warm this morning. No jerseys or jackets required. Okay, well it seems like Jamie's back. So I'm gonna go look at this. Look for Tingana's tracks. While I do that, let's see how the search for the Queen is going.
While Brent goes off in search of Tingana, we are scouring the southern boundary on our way to Cheetah Plains just to see whether or not the Queen of Juma has popped back in to pay us a visit. It doesn't seem as though she has, though. I haven't found any tracks crossing back in, only her tracks from yesterday, where she went out. Now, it is, of course, very, very sad news about Shaluva. But that being said, for those of you who are new to these live safaris, please don't villainize Tingana just because of what he's done. They, animals play by completely different rules. They're not human beings. They do things for their own reasons that we don't necessarily always understand. And we can't judge them in that kind of way. It's a difficult situation because automatically as a human being, he's the bad guy. He killed a leopard for no apparent reason, but whatever his reasons were, we won't begin to understand them. And he's not a bad leopard. He just is a leopard. He's just a wild leopard, and that's what wild animals do. And sometimes they do things in completely the most unpredictable ways. In a different way to human beings. Human beings can be equally unpredictable. Now, Jordan, of course, in that situation, poor Shaluva didn't really stand a chance just because of the sheer difference in size between male leopard and a female leopard. There is an enormous sexual dimorphism just in terms of size between the two. So you want to know how you can tell the difference between a male and a female set of leopard tracks. These are all hyena tracks. Not that I remember what a hyena track looks like. So I'm going to... let me try and find a patch of sun and I'll draw it for you. I'm not sure how clearly it's going to show up now. But let's see if we get to the crest. I might find a patch of sun and then I can show you exactly what the difference is. It's just a size thing. So even at his age now, Hosanna, Karuda's 9.5-month-old baby boy, at 9.5 months old, his feet are nearly as big as Karula's. By the time he is a year old, his feet will be bigger than his mother's. So there is an enormous difference just in terms of the size of their feet. A male's tracks are probably bigger. They're about twice the size, not probably bigger, they are twice the size of a female's tracks. And we got to, of course, each and every leopard is different. Each and every leopard is a different size. Shaluva, for example, having seen her and having been up close to her now, or up close to her remains, she was much, much bigger than Karula. She was a big leopard. Okay, let's try here. With a hippo track for scale. Right. I'm trapped now. Let me get out. Some interesting news coming through from Brent on the game drive comms, but I'll let him tell you when you go back to him. How's here, Jandre? I also hear a woodlands. It's in there. It's in Chitwa. Would you please come out? Okay, we'll get back to the woodlands question in a moment. I'll keep an eye out for it. And let's not put my shadow in here. So in terms of tracks, this is not the best substrate for drawing. It's not the best canvas in the world. This is probably the size of a male leopard's tracks. Okay, it's not the best track I've ever drawn. But that's the sort of rough size. No, that's a little bit big, but that's sort of the rough size of a male leopard. Female leopard would be roughly half the size. So my apologies for the fact that my skill in this sort of sand is relatively limited, but that gives you a rough idea. They really are about double the size in terms of their track size. Right, Kingfisher, come here. This way. We spoke at the beginning of the sunrise safari about the most beautiful birds. Kingfishers, woodlands kingfishers are particularly pretty. I was thinking about that, just in terms of the most colorful and the most beautiful birds, and thinking about bee eaters. I think carmine bee eaters are particularly beautiful. I'm not sure how many of you feel. And it's not just because I'm a girl and they're pink. They really are beautiful birds. Where's this woodland, Jandre? It's gone quiet now. It's like it knows we're looking for them. Oh, wow. So Hannah, who is 9 years old, thank you for sending that through, Hannah. And I'm sorry, I'm distracted, but that's a really lovely choice. Hannah says that the white-bellied sunbird is her favorite. And I think, Hannah, we should show everybody a picture of what a white-bellied sunbird looks like, although pictures never quite do birds justice, do they? You just don't quite get that shimmer in their feathers. And go forward a little bit, wait for the woodlands to come up, and I'll show you a picture of Hannah's white-bellied sunbird. Sunbirds are beautiful. I was thinking about the shrikes as well. There's something called a gorgeous bush shrike, which is really, truly beautiful. We don't see them here. Come on, Kingfisher. Out you pop. Let's quickly find Hannah's white-bellied sunbird. Oh, goodness, there are so many sunbirds. White-bellied. Here we go. That is Hannah's white-bellied sunbird, her most beautiful bird. And the feathers shine in the sun, and that purple band is very, very prominent. Oh, it's moved further in. I can hear the woodland's kingfisher. In fact, all of the sunbirds are beautiful and very delicate looking when compared to the lilac-breasted roller. Jandre, what do you think is the most beautiful bird? Oh, you said marabou stork. Yes, I remember now. Yeah. I think of all of the birds, I think it's safe to say that the marabou stork is probably not going to win awards for the most beautiful. It is not winning any beauty contests, Jandre. Yes, I'm sure they have lovely personalities, and you're right, that's not all about looks, and everyone loves a bird that feeds off rotting carcasses. What was the other one I was thinking of? I said bee eaters, shrikes. Yes, and those of you who are watching the glimmer of the sun and the spider webs, we've obviously driven through a road where the spiders have put their webs all the way across, and our antenna, our hood ornament on the front, has collected all of them. It's very pretty. What a pretty morning. Can you see them glimmering there? Or trying to. Let's get some sun on it. Hold on. Whoa. I hope none of you are prone to feeling a bit motion sick. Oh, it's so green here. You see them? Oh, sorry, move my head. There we go. Jamie's large head was in the way. Yes, we have been collecting spider webs left, right, and center. I will never forget one of the girls that I did my guide training course with. She was absolutely petrified, petrified of spiders. And in summer, we used to drive next to a large river and collect the massive spider webs of the golden orb spiders, sometimes with the spider still attached. And she went from, because safari vehicles usually have three rows of seats. She went from the middle seat to the back seat without touching the middle. No, she went from the front seat to the back seat without touching the middle. She was running on the spot, shouting nine. She was German. Nine, 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 nine. Because a golden orb spider had fallen into the vehicle with her. And after that, one of us always used to sit in the tracker seat with a stick and collect the spider webs on our way. And I learned very quickly when guiding guests, they really don't appreciate it when a spider lands in their lap. So as a result, I often spend time doing this. Not too worried about Jandre. He'll be okay. What on earth is going on here? What are these? What are these tracks? Mystery tracks. Ah, looks like honey badger tracks, I think. They're not very clear. They're basically just impressions in the sand. So I'm not going to stop and show you because it won't make any sense to you, really. They're just what we affectionately call doikies in the sand. I was hoping it might be Tundi's tracks. It'd be so lovely to catch up with Tundi and her cub. The one and only time I saw Tundi's cubs was when they were being chased by baboons. So I would like a nice peaceful sighting with them, since Tundi is one of my absolute favourite leopards. Hat! Oh, let's see what I've gained. Or perhaps Jandre's gained. Let's see how it looks. Sorry, parked a little bit close to it. Aw, shame. Ooh, looks quite an expensive looking one. Sorry. It's quite a nice hat. It's got a drawstring, stop it from blowing off. I can't take my hat off because my microphone lives in there, obviously. I'm not just being a clown. I can't take my hat off. Now, in that case, I'm going to have to give it to Jandre, I think. Shame. I will call it in first. I'm in for now. I'm not just going to steal some poor person's hat. This is quite an expensive looking one as well. It's even got a little hole so that the air flows into the said person's head. Shame. Somebody was probably quite upset when that blew off. And they were either they didn't notice or they were too shy to tell the guide to stop and to turn round. I will call it in. I will try and find the owner of said hat. Shame. See if it has a name in it. I mean, what are the chances? Who marks their clothes? You never know. Sometimes visitors do odd things. No. But I can tell you it was made in China. Right. So while I track down the owner of this hat and see if I can't locate them, let's go over to Brent, who's been doing some tracking of his own.
Okay, well, it looks like now a female leopard might have joined this. So there's tracks of a male and female leopard. They've gone into this very thick area here. I'm just doing a loop around to see if any tracks come out. Now, interestingly enough, earlier this morning, Eggsy told me he heard something that sounded like fighting, but not lions. So when I made the noise, he said, yes, that's it. So there is a possibility that these cats could be mating. I'm just going very slowly. Don't want to miss any tracks. And also, hopefully, we can hear. No tracks yet. Oh dear. So the first answer in is millipede for the tracking quiz. It was not a millipede. It was not a millipede, but it was a nocturnal critter. Now, for those of you might be new, when you see my head hanging off the side of the vehicle like that, it means that I'm looking for the footprints of the big cats. So far, no tracks, which is not a bad thing, which means they might still be in here, which also means that we might switch off and do a little listening a little later, listening for the very distinct sound of felines mating. Let's hope they haven't crossed it north into Buffalo's Hook. They're squirrel alarming. No, it's a funny starling sound. Very well done to Claire, who's spot on. Indeed, it is the tracks of a scorpion. Judging from the size, more than likely, and where it is, a Pistothelmus, one of the Pistothelmus species. Also known as shiny burrowing scorpions. Probably our most common family of ground-dwelling scorpions here on Juma. Just since we are looking for things, there's a nice bird. Just to keep the bird list ticking inadvertently while we search for leopards. And here we go. There's a Burchell's starling. Now, of course, when we stop to look for birds, it also gives us a chance to listen. Not only are we listening for that very distinct sound of leopards mating, oh, off he goes. We're also looking for the sound of impala snorting. No. Impala, kudu, any alarm call, squirrel that might lead us to where those leopards could be. So on average, leopards will mate every 15 minutes for 3 or 4 days. They can move quite vast distances. Normally, the females will follow the male out of their territory in search of him. And while he goes on his territorial patrols. Oh. Well, there's a lone buffalo bull by the looks of things. Oh, he's coming towards us. Wind is starting to pick up, and it is already very warm. That's strange. Let's go have a closer look at that buffalo. I'm just being a bit careful. He's saying, he's making some strange noises. He could be searching for a big herd, or he could be not in the best way. Now, of course, during the drought, the buffalo get afflicted by quite a few different things. And, of course, malnutrition being the main one. But also, certain parasitic species become very, very dominant in that time. And probably one of the stranger ones, and ones that can cause buffaloes to be quite aggressive, and that's because they can't see anymore, is that certain botfly larvae actually go into the sinuses and then into the optic cavity, and they eat through the optic nerve. Although this one, I think, is just rather tracking other buffalo. See how it's got nose to the ground, not feeding, sniffing, looking for a herd. And at his back feet, eggs, just to keep the bird list ticking. Oh, catching insects that are disturbed by the buffalo. There we go. Is it a greater blue-eared, or is it a Cape Glossy? We're not going to be able to see till he steps into the light or flies away. There we go. He's landed. Let's have a quick look to ID the bird there, eggs. To the left. A little bit more. It's up in a tree now. He's back down on the ground. A little bit more to the left. There we go. Now, what we're looking for is dark ears, and that one doesn't happen. So it's Cape Glossy starling. Another one for the list. Buffalo calling. Looking for other buffalo friends. See that nose? There he is. On the ground, sniffing away. Sorry guys, just to be on the radio for a second. Standing by. Copy, Rex, is it 101 sat? Copy, thanks. I think Jamie's closer, she might give you a hand in that area. Oh no, sorry, she's gone east. I'm gonna keep following this one unknown Gonzo. It hasn't come out of the block yet. I'm gonna check back towards the northern end of Aubrey's. Okay, so Rexon's found female leopard tracks, but way down south, so that could be Karula. We're gonna keep following these male and female tracks here. Herbie's up, standing by Herb. Herbie, I had Nkonzo of Wansati and one in the Ingwe. They go into the block between Aubrey's and Sandy Patch. And then there's also Ngala and Nkonzo on vertical axis, halfway between Aubrey's and Gallagher Shortcut. Okay, just going really slowly. Copy. We're just going very, very slowly. Oh! Look at that. There's a little bug. Where must I put it? There. I think you saw one of these. Oh, I'm just trying to, the light's really bad here. Let me just keep still. One of these with Jamie, and it was crawling all over her. Now, it is a beetle, and I've absolutely forgotten its name, and I have to go look it up again. But you see how it's got those yellow spots on it? There's a very important reason for that. It's a mimic, and what it's doing is mimicking a blister beetle or a meloid that can spray formic acid. And this one is a male, and you can often tell male beetles if you look, oh, in full zoom, X, if you look at his antennae, you can see they're feathered. Now, those feathers, if it was a female, his antennae wouldn't be that feathered, because he needs those antennae to pick up the pheromones from the female, and he'll be able to find her like that. So with male beetles, you'll often find very feathered antennae, and the females not so feathered. But those little yellow spots, he's trying to mimic one of the very poisonous beetles, the meloids, or the blister beetle family. This one in particular is completely harmless, and I'm gonna have to double check on his name for you. I've just drawn a complete blank. I do know him from last, or I've known him from a couple of, I've seen them quite a few times in the summer months, but go look for ladies somewhere else. There we go, mister. No lady beetles in our vehicle. So the reason we're going so slowly is to make sure we don't miss a track. Slowly. Oh, we've got a herd of impala coming up. Are we going to see the second impala baby? Well, these guys aren't having babies. Those are all males on the left, girls on the right. No sign of little rugrats on the ones on the right yet. There are some ladies looking like they're about to burst. Let's just find a gap through the bush here. Here we go, some very pregnant females through there. Now, James Baz wondering, won't the lambing of the impala be a boom for the lion and the leopard? Most certainly it will, James. Well, a leopard's particularly for the impala, but baby wildebeest is something that lions like a lot. There we go, that female, the last female coming through, she's very heavily pregnant. Okay. Well, at least we know we've got our impala watchdogs on this side of this block of bush that we think that, or we know the leopards have gone into, we just don't know if they've come out of. So if they are still in there and they keep coming this way, we should hopefully hear the snorts of the impala to tell us where the leopards are. Still no sign of them coming out. I'm pretty confident that hopefully we're going to find them, unless they've crossed into Buffalo's Hook. Then unfortunately, doesn't matter how good a tracker you are, if you can't go there, you can't find them. Okay, I'm just gonna chat to Herbie quickly. Update from Rexon about Karula's tracks. I'm just listening carefully. Herbie. Herb, while you're on foot, just can you listen carefully? Xander thought he heard something sounded like fighting. I think it could have been mating Ingwe, but I didn't hear it this morning. But so just keep a listen out. If you do hear something, please let me know. Deploying the troops, giving us the maximum amount of chance to find these leopards. And speaking of troops, there's still one member of the team who you haven't met yet, so let's go say good morrow to Byron.
Good morning everybody and welcome on the bushwalk. My name's Byron and on camera this morning is VM, and then Herbie always around with us. It's great to have you on the walk this morning. We're just getting started. What we're actually going to do, our plan this morning is possibly try and help Brent find those leopards. So with us being on foot, it might be a bit easier firstly to see tracks and then possibly hear them if we are lucky and if they are mating. So we're going to head into that area and see if we can't help Brent with those leopards. That would be wonderful. So let's get going and see what we can find along the way. Some beautiful grey hornbills calling at the moment. I'm trying to see if I can find them for you. They're a little bit far. I think they've flown off, unfortunately. See what else we can find. Any tracks along here? Dale, you want to know, why do big cats fight during mating? So it's not necessarily a case of them fighting. I think what happens is they do get a bit aggressive, and the reason for that, and Dale, if I can explain it like this, what happens is the females, when they present themselves, especially for leopards, let's take leopards for example, when the females present themselves to the male, and that's the thing, it's the females that go and present themselves to the male doesn't really have to do much, he just needs to have a big territory. So what happens is, while the female comes and presents herself and the male mates with the male actually has a slightly barbed penis, and what happens is it hurts the female. So you'll see when the males do mount the females and they actually bite the back of their neck, and what happens is the reason they do that is to try and, one, the theory is that it tries to relax the female and also to prevent her from turning and hitting the male when he is mating with her, because it is quite painful for the female. When the male gets off the female, she'll often turn around and swipe and try and hit him because it is sore. But the reason for that barred penis is it is to try and induce ovulation. So hopefully that the mating that they are doing is more successful. So that's why they have that. But that's usually when people think, oh, they're fighting, but that's what happens, and that's part of the mating process. And you see it a lot, especially with leopards. But lions do it too. Obviously, lionesses will get quite upset. Similar reaction to the male lions. But with leopards, you often see this leopard male, the male jumping off the female, and the female turning around and swiping and growling, and a lot of growling. So it can be quite an aggressive affair. But it's very short, literally a few seconds with each mating session, and from then they do that fairly regularly, every 10 to 15 minutes for about 3 days to 5 days. So so I'm just trying to listen out and see if we can hear anything at the moment. We'll see anything. We need to try spot a woodland kingfisher. Brent has found the impala lamb, which is. James Richard, you wanted to know, are smaller cat species vocal when mating? To be honest, James, I haven't really witnessed any smaller cats mating out in the wild. I'm assuming that the African wild cat, possibly a little serval, I'm sure they get very, very vocal when they are mating. Very much similar to house cats, I would assume, especially the little wild cats, African wild cats. So I think they do, but I've never heard it. And I've been in areas where there are wild cats. You get wild cats out here too, but I've unfortunately never heard it. So it would be interesting to find out, but I'm sure they do. I'm sure they do, just like normal cats. Trying to look for any tracks along here, just to see if we can find some lion or leopard tracks. I know Brent did have quite a few this morning, but quite a bit further along, not just in this area that we are now. Can hear some parrots calling, but again, they're very, very far. I think that actually, if we have a look, they're probably in that tree. We can see them. I can just see some fluttering about. It is a little bit far for us.
We have just arrived on Cheetah Plains, and I'm not sure if poor Brent perhaps lost signal wherever he happened to be, but I've got a really, really nice thing to show you. Jean-Ro, from where I've parked, are you going to be able to... Yes, you should be able to see them. I'm going to try and detach myself from the various cables. The various cables of the vehicle. This is just a minor topple out of the car. Fine, all under control, promise. Got something absolutely adorable here. That at first I went, there's a leopard, we've missed it. It's going straight towards the Annette's boundary. It's not a leopard, and the reason that I know it's not a leopard is because here are mom's tracks walking all the way along this road. So these are lion tracks, and those of you who are familiar with the Cheetah Plains area, you'll know exactly what it is that I'm talking about. A lion walked that way, and something with very, very tiny feet walked with her. And these are the tiny little feet here. Already not actually that tiny. It's amazing how fast lion cub feet actually grow. But these are the tracks of the brand new Styx cubs that have followed mom out, and off they go. And in fact, it looks as though, from what I can see along this road, it looks as though the whole pride has come walking along, or at least two adult females. I can only see one set of cub tracks, but that's doesn't mean that the rest of them weren't with her. It might mean that they were walking along the side. Now, for those of you that have just joined us, the Styx cubs at the moment are about that big. I'm really, really hoping... Well, I was really hoping that we have a chance to see them. Unfortunately, the Annette's boundary, which is outside of our traverse area, is about 100 meters or so that way. So the fact that I haven't been growled at because they would have growled at me at this proximity. The fact that I haven't been growled at while I'm out of the vehicle tells me immediately that unfortunately the sticks have gone outside of our traverse area. But I might go and patrol that boundary just, you never know, just in case. It would be very nice after the sadness of the first litter of sticks cubs. It would be really very nice to have a positive sighting with them. Have a chance. Sorry. Just hold on 1 second. I'm just listening to the game drive comms. Okay. They found the tracks on Annette's. They found the tracks further on Annette's. Sorry, that was all I wanted to listen for. It was good timing, actually, from the moment I plugged my earpiece in. The game drive comms are a way of us communicating with other guides. Sometimes they work better than others, but we sort of can combine our skill and our time in finding them. Oh, Maria, I'm sorry. Ah, you wanted to know how big an adult lion print is. Roughly the size of my hand, but I'll try and find you a better example. These are all a little bit rough around the edges, but I suppose they will serve our purpose. Ah, somebody's already been here and seen them. Sorry, Maria. Ah, there we go. There's a good one. Here's a good example, just to answer Maria's question quickly. Maria wants to know how big an adult lion track is. Hopping out one more time. This is how big an adult lioness track is. Can you see this one, Jandre? You can. So, slightly smaller, of course, than a adult male lion. An adult male lion would be a little bit larger than, just a little bit larger than my outspread hand. But this is the track here. These are the back, this is the back of the track. The three lobes at the back. And these are the four toes. So it tells me that this animal's going that way. And then crisscrossing on top of her tracks, as we always see with little baby animals, is the cubs weaving around her. A lovely set of tracks to see first thing in the morning. I have to confess it would be lovelier still if they were going that way. But alas, they are not. They are on a net. But we'll just have to keep trying with the sticks. I really want to see those brand new cubs. Chandra's sad. His lower lip is drooping. I'm sad too, Chandra. Next time. So there we go. That gives you an idea as to how big a lion's footprint is. Already, at just a few weeks old, the lion cub's tracks are nearly as big as the female leopard's tracks. And the reason that we know they're not female leopard tracks is, first of all, the toes are bigger in proportion to the back of the foot. And secondly, they're weaving in and out of an adult lion's tracks. So you never ever see lion cub tracks on their own until the point that they're big enough to be unmistakably lion rather than leopard. Now there is some serious work happening at Juma Dam. They're busy strengthening the dam walls, which is basically, it's a water hole here. So you might see some large graders and various earth movers. We might even see a cat, a caterpillar grader. But let's see how we do. We can't not have cats this morning. That would break our cat streak. Aww. There's nothing sadder than driving away from fresh tracks that are going the other way and knowing that you can't follow them. Get a little wrench inside your chest when you do it. Okay, so Juma Dam is being reconstructed. Hello. Sorry, I know I'm not... Okay, now which way? Which way should we go, Jandre? This way, I think. Away from the noises. going to go off to Cheetah Plains. No, I'm going to go three in a row, plan first, then Cheetah Plains open area. In the meantime, let us see how Brent's morning is treating him.
Well, I got a call on the radio from Rexon that he found Krula, and I can't hear. Something chased her, so I'm rushing to that area to see what's going on. It sounds like something was trying to steal the kill from her, but I couldn't really hear on the radio. So we're nearly there. So exciting times. I don't know what's going on. Rex is going to keep trying to follow Krula. She might be heading south to fetch the cubs. Okay, hold on. Okay. So he found her in pretty much the exact same position. We found her a few days ago on that Diker kill, and I couldn't really hear what he was saying, so I just decided we'd get to this area as quickly as possible. Byron and Herbie are heading towards those tracks we left. See if they get any luck there. Okay, we're nearly there. Okay. I'm trying to see where Rexon's tracks were. What was trying to... Let me just get hold of him quickly. Rex. Rex, I'm in that position. Confirm that Nyama is almost where the Munti was last time. You think she went south from here, maybe to fetch my boom button? Okay, so there's a kill here. Rex says he's not sure whether the Krula's here or she's gone to go try find or fetch the cubs. So he says the best way is to go where I went last time, which is on top. So I'm going to try to get over there. Just hang on a second. It's a relatively tricky spot, but fortunately, it's not the first time we've been on this rodeo. So she could be lying up on top, and I'm not sure. So anyway, while we try maneuver through this difficult spot, let's go see what Byron's up to on foot. Watch your head, eggs.
So we are in the area now where Brent was looking around this morning, and he saw some lion tracks and potentially heard or wanted to find a leopard or mating pair of leopards. Just listening a second. Hear something moving. But have a look here, everyone. Here are the lion tracks that we were looking for, or the lions that we are looking for. Here's a beautiful lion track over here. One of the lioness or lionesses, but there are two tracks of lionesses here. There's another one just off to the side. So they've walked all along the road, and it looks like they were chasing buffalo, which is very interesting. We could see the scuff marks of where these cats had run, and also where the buffalo had tried to turn and were running across the road. So who knows, we might find these Nkuhuma pride on another buffalo kill. That would be very, very interesting. So what we're doing now is we're just walking very carefully and trying to listen out. It did sound like we heard some zebra alarm calls earlier. So it's very exciting. It's wonderful to be able to try and track lions on foot and hopefully find them, especially if they're on a kill. It's definitely heating up a bit here at the moment. Temperature is getting very, very warm. So these tracks head all along the road. Beautiful clear tracks from early this morning or possibly last night. But very, very fresh tracks walking along here. I can hear a squirrel alarm calling, but I think maybe it's alarm calling at Herbert. He's up ahead. It could potentially be alarm calling at him. And the thing with walking though is you've got to constantly scan. We saw it the other day, we were watching some elephant, which was a wonderful sight. You could see and hear the elephant moving through the bushes. And before we knew it, there was a buffalo that stuck its head up or out of the bushes just to our left. And we didn't really notice it until Herbie spotted it. But just shows you've got to always scan and always be aware of what's around you when you are on a bushwalk. And listening, you've got to really use all of your senses when you are out here. Listen, your sense of smell is also important. Might pick up the whiff of a carcass perhaps. So all of our senses, because often you might even hear the animal before you actually see it. Let's have a look here. Still got lion tracks going along the road. And the cubs are with them. So there are lion cub tracks here too. Let's have a look. So we're going to double check around this area, try and find out exactly which direction these lions have gone. Sounds like Brent has found the carcass that Karula had. Let's go have a look.
So we are here in the exact same position where Karula had a Daika a few days ago, and she's caught another baby Inyala. Oh, copy Rex, I'll check down towards Twin Dams. There we go. So I'm pretty sure she's gone to fetch the cubs. Oh, Eggsy in front of us quickly. No, don't fly away. It's gone. It was a great spotted cuckoo. It's the second time we've seen them in this area. Can hear them calling. But so Karula's not here. I'm pretty sure she's headed south to go fetch Shongile and Hosana. And that's very good. So for the sunset safari, there's a very good chance that they're going to be right here now. And Rexon's gone to check up in case she went through the Weaver's Nest area, Treehouse Dam area, to fetch the cubs. But she could have also put the cubs further to the east. So that's what we're going to do now. So we're going to head down towards Twin Dams Road, see if she's not coming back from the south in that area. And while we extricate ourselves from this spot, let's go see what's happening in the Far East with Jamie.
That is really very exciting news about the Queen of Juma and her two gorgeous cubs. In the meantime, I've got exciting news of my own, or at least I think it's exciting, and I think some of you will as well. This is the best, one of the best, in fact the best, example of this track that I have ever seen, in at least in my time at Wild Earth. And let me jump out to show you exactly what it is I'm looking at. These are really beautifully fresh, and this particular animal did this, scurried across the road here, and then scurried back, and then scurried back, and crisscrossed all the way along here. I don't know what it was looking for, unless there were two, which is a possibility with this particular species. So these are the tracks I'm looking at here, and they're beautifully crisp and fresh, and I'm trying to think which is going to be the best example to show you. I think maybe this one would be, although we've got two sets here. Now, what the first thing you'll notice is the length of this animal. This is the track of the back left and the front left, and this here is the track of the front right and the back right. So it's a long animal. It's something long with relatively large feet, and looking clearly in the dirt, the front foot has fallen over the back foot. No, sorry, that's not right. The back foot has fallen over the front foot. I had a moment there. So the front feet are slightly more elongated, and you've got this massive gap where the imprint of the claws stretch away from the footprint of this particular animal. And that immediately tells us what it is. It's a honey badger. And one of the most distinctive features of a honey badger track, they've got five toes clearly visible, but three of them fall into a very clear pattern next to each other. And then you've got the foot itself, which is sort of shaped like this to try and describe. Then you've got your toes here. And the claws fall about a centimeter or so just a fraction of an inch away from the foot itself, away from the toes itself. So that's a sort of a rough diagram, but this is probably the clearest example of honey badger tracks I have seen in a very, very long time. The only other thing that you could confuse that for is a porcupine, but in soil as soft as this, and it is very, very soft, fine soil, if it were a porcupine track, you'd get the trails of the quills very, very finely in the dirt behind it. Porcupines tend to drag their tails ever so slightly. So it's not a porcupine, it is a honey badger, and it might even be a pair of honey badgers. And I'm going to try and show you as we go along here, because these tracks are stunning. And I don't know if it's a thing that all guides do, but we get particularly excited about such clear tracks. It's quite the leap that I have to do to get back into the car. Right, let me try and show you another example. Really beautiful tracks for those of you that are keeping tracking scrapbooks with screenshots of different tracks. These are a beautiful example. I don't even know how I managed to find myself in this position. Got so excited by the tracks, it's all a blur. Sorry, Strychnos. Okay, we're going to be driving at a very awkward angle for a moment. There's another nice example over here. If we have a look, let me try and do this whilst watching the monitor over here. And you can actually clearly see the claws because the sand is slightly thicker. You can actually clearly see the claws coming through. A really lovely example of a honey badger track. I don't know what this honey badger was doing, unless it was a little one with babies, because it seems to be crossing backwards and forwards. It is entirely possible. The females, and there is another track. One more. Just because they're such beautiful examples and the light is just right. Watch out, Jandre. I'm sorry, it'll be worth it, I promise. You happy? I'm stopping. Just one more example of the tracks in the sand over here. And you can actually see in this part, in this particular track, if you have a look, where's my hand? There's my hand. If you have a close look, you can actually see it's less clear in those tracks because the soil was slightly harder. But if we go back down, let's just go back to that back track there. There. These are the claw tracks here. They came through much more clearly. And there's the row of three track, the row of three toes that we were talking about. So a beautiful, beautiful example of a honey badger track. Really quite lovely. I wish we could have seen the actual animal, but this is almost as good. A honey badger, for our newer viewers, I think most of you will know exactly what a honey badger is. They have quite the reputation. They are a mustelid, so kind of like a badger, but they are one of the most, or have a reputation for being one of the most ferocious little animals out here. They're not ferocious, they're just very clever and very determined. Right, as we determinedly carry on our search of cheetah plains, let's go and see what Byron has found on foot.
So I haven't found anything just yet, but I've got to an area with some pushed over broken branches and trees. I'm going to scrounge around here a little bit and see what we can find. But we are still hot on these tracks of these lions, and we've come into a block now. We're just trying to work out where the tracks have gone. So we're going to be listening out very carefully for these lions. Let's see if we can find anything around here. Perhaps a little scorpion or something if we're lucky. And we're looking, look through this leaf litter. Signs of termites and that around here. You can see where the soil and that is around some of the wood. I'm just listening very carefully because every now and then we're getting alarm calls. So we're trying to make sure we don't miss out where these lions are. We think they're possibly in this block somewhere. Let's see what's under here. This could be a good one. We haven't had too much luck with any scorpions during the day. It's interesting. And nothing in here, not even a little spider or anything. Looks like all the insects are still sleeping. I can hear. And it's just, you know, usually, and especially with all the rain that we've had and the moisture, you should start getting a lot more scorpion activity, or these little arachnids moving around, spiders, scorpions. And often we pick up all these logs and under rocks and that, you do find signs of scorpions. And the last few days I haven't, but we have seen scorpions. I mean, we've seen those tree creepers, or those Epistacanthus scorpions. We've seen a few of them around. So there's definitely scorpions around. We just need to find them.
Something making noise in the back there.
Ah, hang on, let's see. Just jumped off. There was a little grasshopper making a noise on the backpack behind VM. A tiny little one like this, but it's just jumped away. Oh, I can hear it again, but further away now. It's on that tree. Let's have a look around this termite mound and just see if there's anything interesting around here. Lots of little holes. Now this is an abandoned termite mound, everybody, and I say that because it's completely open. There are a lot of holes that have been made potentially by other little animals, maybe a little mongoose, ants, but no sign of termites or it being very active. So you may also get some snakes in that in here. They like to move in when the termites have moved out and use this as a home. There's some interesting dung over here. Let's just have a look. Let's have a look at this. Okay. Oh. See this little bit of dung over here. Now this is quite old. It's very, very dry. What would this... Now, I must be honest, this... looks like potentially a little mongoose, or maybe, just trying to have a look, a lot of seeds and pieces of grass in that in here, so it could even be a small porcupine. Everyone, I say that because it looks like there is some grass roots and shoots in here. And that's what porcupines feed on. So potentially porcupine, but this is very, very dry at the moment. It's very brittle, but you can see some plant material in there. Maybe a small porcupine, or possibly a little mongoose or something. Interesting. I don't see any bones. I doubt it would be from a cat or anything like that. But I think that is a little porcupine dropping, small porcupine. Just trying to see which way Herbert's gone now. See where these lions have gone. They are in this area somewhere. I'm trying to look while we're walking too. I'm also just trying to see if there are any tracks around. And a question from Lady Lone Wolf. You'd like to know, what is more dangerous on foot, lion or leopard? Now, both big cats, I wouldn't say that they are dangerous. They're potentially dangerous. It all depends if they feel threatened. So obviously by us walking around and trying to find them on foot, it's not that easy, because they do get quite skittish and they will generally decide to move away from us before they actually confront us. You know, to be honest, I've heard stories of leopards attacking people and injuring a whole group of people, not just one. Lions, I mean, they've killed many people in the past in different areas, so it's hard to say. And it's funny. I would probably prefer to walk into lions than an angry leopard. I must be honest. I think that would be my choice, but it's hard to say which is more dangerous. All depends on the situation. They're both incredibly powerful and can do serious damage. I suppose you'd have perhaps more chance at trying to throw a leopard off of you as opposed to a lion, because a lion's just so much bigger. But leopards are incredibly fast, agile, and so powerful. So I would probably choose a lion over a leopard. All right, we're going to carry on looking and searching this area, listening out for lions. Let's head back to Brent, get an update from him. If we find anything, we'll let you know.
Now, Rexon's found Karula's tracks where they cross down south to go fetch the cubs, so there's a good chance she's going to be back there later. Now, most birds, if you walk towards them, fly away. And I can hear a bird. Can you hear it, Eggs? Now, we're going to see if we can con him into getting on camera. Let's see if it can see me. I'm over here. Oh, can you hear it getting more excited? Now you've got to come fetch me, honey guide. Here he comes. You see him? He's come to fetch me. Have you got him? Eggs?
Yeah.
Okay. There we go. Shame, I feel a bit bad. There's a greater honey guide. All I had to do was jump out, walk, and convince the honey guide that I might follow him. Do I need to move a little bit? How's the picture looking? Let's go forward slightly. There he is, a greater honey guide. Oh, he's off. He thinks I'm following him. Isn't that incredible? All I had to do was just walk a little bit from the vehicle. I could hear him calling just over there. And he immediately came back to fetch me. Here we go, another one for the bird list this morning, the greater honey guide. Now that is that attract attention call for human beings and honey badgers. But the more common call when calling for other honey guides. Oh, we've got another bird here on the left. Don't fly away. There he goes. Should land now. Beautiful bird, the white helmet shrike. You got him, X?
No.
Zoom left. I mean right, other left. That was my fault. Up a bit. Oh, just come a bit wider. So I can just see where the camera is. Okay, right, quite a lot. Long way right. There we go. The rest of them are flying into that bush. Oh, quickly across to Byron.
Right, time to get to us.
Okay, we found the lions, everybody. Look at that. That is incredible. Now, we are in this block that we've been walking through, and you might be able to see that some of them moving from right to left. I think some of the youngsters were a bit startled. Let's walk this way. Just follow me. Let's see if we can get another view of them. I don't want to push them too much and cause them to run away. But just as I mentioned earlier, these lions prefer moving away from us. So exciting, isn't that fantastic? So we told you they were very, very close. We had their tracks coming into this area, and it did look like they were hunting buffalo, but I'm not sure if they were successful. The wind is swirling a little bit, but I think it's still in our favor. Just trying to get another glimpse of them. See that, you know, they're moving through some thick trees and that. Now let's keep going and having a look. Very, very different experience being on foot and viewing animals, and you can see how they react differently to us. Okay. All right, so Herbie and I think let's try aim for a termite mound up ahead. Just see if we can't get a glimpse of them. But again, I think what's happened is they definitely heard us or saw us, and they decided to move away from us, which is usually what lions do, everyone. They do, yeah. Yeah, there they go. I can just get a glimpse of them every now and then moving through the bush. And just shows you how fortunate we are. And a lot of our viewers always ask, well, what happens? Why are we able to get so close to these lions when we're on a vehicle? And it's purely because they've become habituated to the vehicles, and not tame at all, but they're used to the vehicles. They know there's no threat or danger. But on foot, it's obviously completely different. There they go. Can just get, might get them moving through there. Let's see if we might, maybe we get a view up on this termite mound from here.
One.
Oh, there we go. There are some more coming, so we'll just stay focused on that spot. You can see them, but not interested in staying around close to us. So we're not going to push them anymore. We don't want to cause them to run away too far. So what we're going to do is just rather back off from here, and then we'll try radio Brent or Jamie. I'm not too sure where they are now, or somebody in the area. I'm sure someone will respond and come and view these lions, and then hopefully we'll get to show you some of them from the vehicle later. I know Brent is on his way. But wonderful, that's so exciting. I'm so glad. But it's amazing how they can disappear. They've just all disappeared behind us. There's another lioness walking through there. It's very difficult. You just get these tawny shapes moving through the trees and away from us. But like I said, I don't want to push them too much, cause them to run away too far. Isn't that amazing? Well done, Herbie, on his tracking and that. There, you can just see they're still moving away from us. So, typical lion behaviors. They choose, especially with young cubs, probably choose to get up and move away rather. Only if you really surprise them will they probably react to you, start growling, and most likely act aggressively. But if they see you coming and hear us, which they most likely did, then they decided to just move off, which is very, very interesting. All right, let's head to Brent. I think he's coming into this area. Let's get an update from him, see how far he is, and hopefully we'll get to show you those lions from the vehicle.
Well done, Byron. Awesome stuff. Now, with Karula all the way down south, fetching the cubs, I'm gonna make my way towards the lions. Herbie's just calling me now to let me know exactly where they are. Standing by. Make my way towards you. Confirm, what's your position? FM. I'll be there in 5 minutes. Okay, exciting stuff. And we're going to head towards, I'm presuming, the Inkahumas, but you never know. Standing by. The walk's just located, I'm assuming, the Inkahumas, so I'm just heading there. Now, I couldn't hear what Rexon said was trying to steal Karula's kill, so I bumped into Rexon, I had a chat with him, and I'm not gonna lie, I'm very jealous. So Karula has left that kill there, and she's gone off to fetch the cubs. Now that could take quite a while, because I know they are quite far south. So when Rexon first got there, when he called me to tell me he had found Karula, and I learned a new Shangaan word today because of this. And he's like, I've got to come, so I'm on my way. He goes, oh no, sorry, but it was Mkloti that was stealing from her. And I was like, Mkloti? Did he mean Makoti, which is vultures, or did he? And I was sitting there going, I don't know what this is. I really don't. And I normally, when it comes to animal names in most languages, I'm pretty good. And so I... Hang on 1 second, Herbie sounds like he needs me. Standing by. Okay, copy, thanks very much, Herb. I'm coming on to quarantine now. Okay, sorry, back to the story. Okay, now, Mkloti, and I'm sitting there going, I do not have a clue what Rexon is talking about. And then when I saw him, he told me what it is. A serval was scavenging off Karula's kill. How incredible is that? Now, we're pretty sure Karula killed it. Rexon found the drag marks from where she had caught it and dragged it there, and tracks from there heading to the south to go fetch the cubs. But incredible that serval took... Oh, yes, here it is. Eggsy, are you ready? Are you ready, Eggsy? Now, where did it go? Don't fly again. Okay, you see the bird on the far left-hand side of the lower branch. Quickly zoom in. Left a little and zoom more. There it is. Oh, there you go, boom, there it is. Woodlands kingfisher. Here we go. Now, I know Byron says he saw one flash through the screen. This isn't flashing. This is sitting perfectly, 100% confirmation. Oof, what a day, Woodlands and Baby Impala. Now, I actually heard them calling for the first time nicely this morning. When I woke up, here we go. Definitely worth taking a few seconds on our way to the lions to have a look at the exquisite Woodlands kingfisher. I'm hoping he jumps out into the light so you can see that electric blue color that is on him. And that's how I spotted him, just as that electric blue color shot through the sort of far left-hand side of my vision. There's only one bird that's got that coloration to that extent out here. Come on, give us a chirr. Oh, there he goes. There we go, Woodlands. Bina, well done. Bina says 173 on her list, the Woodlands Kingfisher. Oh yeah, now we can go look for some lions. And those lions actually sound like they're quite close to the baby impala. But it's getting warm, so I don't know if the lions are going to be too mobile. And I'm thinking about torturing Eggsy. Oh, I won't torture you just yet. And there was a barn swallow, or a European swallow, who spend most of their time on the wing, which makes them incredibly difficult to get on camera. But so far, what a lovely morning. Now, I'm probably not going to be saying that come 8 a.m. when it's going to be 100 degrees Fahrenheit, or maybe not quite. I think it's probably, well, how hot do you think it is at the moment, Eggs? Hot enough. Come on, Eggsy. We like the heat, yeah, we love the heat. Don't like the cold so much. I'd say it's probably a very, very 85, 80. Between 80 and 85 Fahrenheit, and it's not even 7 a.m. yet, or is it? I don't know. Not really a clock watcher. No, it's not 7 a.m. So before 7 a.m., it's gonna, I reckon by 8 a.m. it's gonna at least be 90. That's my predictions. We can always get final control to check the weather station a little later and let us know. Oh, apparently I'm wrong according to final control. I said it was 70, I said between 80 and 85, it's 79. Forgive me a degree or two, I mean, really. Final control shall not forgive me a degree or two. Okay. Now the lion should be about probably 200, 300 meters up ahead. And it has been one of those wonderful mornings. I think because I suffered so greatly yesterday at the hands of some evil, evil hairy caterpillars, I'm being blessed with baby impalas and Woodlands kingfishers, and hopefully some lions shortly. And Sunset Safari, I'm pretty sure we're going to catch up with Queen Karula. And I know this sounds terrible. Normally, I always want to find Queen Karula, but imagine going back there and seeing a serval as well. And hopefully, not in the jaws of Queen Karula. We don't see them that often. Okay. Now we're just the first baby pigs, baby warthogs of the year would be quite nice. And also, first baby wildebeest. Wildebeest normally a little bit later than the impala, although with this year, difficult to say. Okay, so what Herbie is telling me, there's a big game path that goes to a big termite mound up ahead from Vuyatila access, and that's where he thinks the lions are going to pop out. Okay, so not this big termite mound, of course. I'm talking about the other big termite mound. You know that termite mound? That termite mound. Now, as strange as it sounds, termite mounds are quite a big point of reference for us out here, especially since we've all walked through these areas extensively. So when we say that big game path that goes from Aubrey's to that big termite mound, we know exactly what Herbie is saying. Going to be this big termite mound, but they're probably still inside the block. See, this is the big termite mound. There we go, nice big termite mound. And then this is the big game path. But before we go off-road, I just want to make sure they haven't popped out a little bit further down. Just making sure. Inkahumas, where are you? I think Inkahumas are already snoozing in the shade. Okay, no sign of them popping out yet, so let's go back to the big game path. Okay, oopsie. Let's go back. No. Last station, go again with species, sorry. Thanks. I'm trying to make my way into where our walking team found the lions. I'll update to the next five. Okay. Well, it seems like Byron's having an absolutely storming morning on foot, and he's already found the lions, and now it seems like he's found another member of the big five.
Yeah, we have indeed found some elephant, everyone. Just straight through there we've found, it looks like a small herd. I've only seen two. I'm going to see if we can try to see some more for you. They're just steadily feeding. So what we're going to do is, the wind is actually blowing from our right to our left, which is good. It's not blowing directly to them. So we're going to just move around slowly and just see if we can't get a view from the other side. Follow me. Let's just have a look. In these herds of elephant, you do have to be careful when there are youngsters around, but Generally, the elephants are quite relaxed. As long as you keep quiet and view them from a distance, then it's not too bad. I'll just see how many there are. I don't know how many there are. All I heard was the branches breaking, and we came and had a look. Could actually hear some of the dung dropping, hitting the ground, and that's how we spotted them. Nice big termite mound up ahead. Could potentially use that if we need to, just to get a vantage point perhaps, or to get behind. Let's see, now you can see it's very thick up ahead at the moment. So I just want to stop and listen, just see if we can't get some movement. Sounds like they're moving a little bit away from us, which is good. So we can carry on. Just lower my voice quite a bit, so I don't want to startle the elephants if we do come through and see them. Where are they hiding? It's incredible how these massive grey animals can just disappear. There were one or two off to the right, but it seems like they've caught up with the others and they've moved on. That's amazing. They've basically just disappeared. Hold on. Do you want to tell him maybe where they are? Sorry, Brent's looking for the lions. We're not too far from the area where the lions are. So Herbert's just going to give Brent an update and tell him exactly where to start looking. Maggie, you asked, are elephants really afraid of mice? No, only on Disney movies. They're not. Not at all. I think elephants are actually afraid of very little. We saw it, when was it? The last stint I did, yeah, so 3 weeks ago, we had the Unkahuma Pride hunting buffalo, and the buffalo managed to shake them off, and the next thing, a herd of elephant came out, and one elephant specifically came and chased a whole pride of lions away. So I doubt a little mouse would scare an elephant. Let me just have a look. Keep coming with us. Just walking slowly and scanning. But I wouldn't be surprised if the elephant actually heard us and just decided to move on a little bit. Their senses are so incredible, their sense of hearing, sense of smell. It's nice and open here now, so we should be able to see them. Well, it's opening up a little bit, but I can't see any elephant anywhere. Sure, how's that? A quick glimpse of them and they're gone. Just shows you, everyone, you know, even people often ask about the safety while being in the bush, and yes, you do have to be very careful and very alert all the time, but generally, and we've seen it twice now, animals will try and avoid people because to them they view us as a potential predator. They don't know what we are, and we don't occur out here, so the reason for them to move off is just purely for safety. Unless you really surprise them, then perhaps you may get a reaction out of them, and when they may act aggressively. Not giving up just yet. Still want to see where these elephants have gone. Can't hear them anymore. Maybe these elephants are a little camera shy. Alright, well, are we going to continue looking for these elephants? Maybe we see them again. And while we do that, let's head back to Jamie on Cheetah Plains, get an update from her.
Oh, well, Byron seeks out his Ellies. I'm searching for anything really on Cheetah Plains. I have to say, it feels deathly quiet here. Not deathly, deathly is the wrong word. It feels very quiet. It feels a little bit like walking through a silent house when you're playing hide and seek with your friends when you're a child and you just can't find anyone, and you start to get that slightly panicky feeling that perhaps they're all playing a trick on you. I'm not getting a panicky feeling, but the animal life at Cheetah Plains and on Mala Mala is hiding this morning. And actually for jolly good reason, because it must be, I would say it's a good 30 degrees already, and it's, what time is it? 7 o'clock in the morning. It is going to be a scorcher today, unless the storm comes in. Unless we get a storm that rolls in. Yesterday it looked like it might. Today, slightly less so. I'm looking for anything. Ground hornbill. The cheetah unfortunately went north yesterday. So they are on their sort of regular patrol route right up towards Manuleti. So essentially what they've got to do is they've got to go through Cheetah Plains, Inkoro, Torchwood, Buffelshoek, and then into Manuleti in terms of the different properties. And then turn around and come all the way back. So they usually do that at a regular cycle. They've been a bit off over the last few weeks. I'm not entirely sure why. Perhaps one of them was, perhaps they were distracted by a female, for example. But usually they follow a relatively regular circular pattern in terms of marking their territory. Female cheetah, on the other hand, do the exact opposite. They actually barely have territories. They have large, undefended home ranges that are essentially makes them nomadic. They barely really have a regular spot that they go to, and that probably explains why we've never seen a female cheetah, but only just really. I still can't believe, Brent says he saw tracks of a female cheetah on Cheetah Plains. I haven't even seen tracks in the year and a half that I've been here. Not even tracks of a female cheetah. So who knows where they're all hiding. Wouldn't it be wonderful to just one day, and it could happen, there is absolutely nothing stopping it from happening, if one day we just went around the corner and there was a female with cubs. She could move them. As I said, they're nomadic. She could just pop up one day. Imagine what that would be like. I think that would probably, unless I'm very much mistaken, and correct me if I am because I don't know, but I think that would probably be a first on these live safaris. I'm not sure that cheetah cubs have ever been seen. There's also a good chance of seeing cheetah cubs. The more time we spend in the Mara, the more chance we have of seeing them, and they really are adorable. And I know that Viam, like for example, if Jeanne and I now were to go around the corner and see a female cheetah with cubs, I don't think Viam would ever forgive us. I think he would be utterly, secretly devastated, because cheetah, and baby cheetah in particular, are one of Viam's absolute favorite animals. Cats in general are VM's thing. He does enjoy filming them. Not that we don't all. Chandra, a steambook could do at this stage. Not that we're...
Fly.
A fly? A fly, perhaps? Ooh, there we go. Anna Marie, you want an ostrich? I found you something smaller. Ooh, I think we're gonna have to go forward, Jeanne. Yeah, I think it's gone into a hole. Got it. Yes! Awesome! How cool is that? Hello, Slender. It's not even looking at us. What madness is this? Oh! Can you still see it, Jeanne? I can't see in my monitor. It's just lying down, isn't it? Our mongoose, our slender mongoose that we never get to see, has just gone flat. That's a new one for me. It has been a very long time since I've spent more than a split second with a slender mongoose, and there we go. Ours is now lying down. That's crazy. Just goes to show the different personalities of the animals out here. He's hot. He or she is hot. And so is resting up in the shade. But what on earth, in this bizarre patch, oh, there's a tortoise as well, but let's not take our eye off the slender mongoose. It tends to move slightly faster than a tortoise. What on earth, on the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains, where hardly anybody drives, is a slightly more habituated mongoose doing? Why is it more relaxed than the other slender mongoose we see? Bizarre. Now, at the moment, what it doesn't realize is that it's been stalked by what looks like a leopard tortoise, slowly but surely making its way off behind it and to the left, creeping up slowly, slowly. Watch out, Slender. If you go a little bit slightly to the left, there. Here we go. The tortoise is coming for the slender mongoose. Oh, maybe they're racing. I think that's a likely explanation. Maybe they're racing and the slender mongoose doesn't want to go too far ahead of the tortoise, unlike the arrogant hare of the Aesop's fables. Perhaps that's what it is. He's waiting for his friend, the tortoise. I've got no idea. The most bizarre things happened on these live safaris. Look at the slender mongoose, it has not moved. Oh, there it goes. Oh, now it's coming closer. Oh, it realized that the tortoise was catching up in this race. There's the black tip of the tail. I don't want to take my eye off it in case I lose it in real life. Here it goes. It's not running away from us, it's just running. It's just... He's there. He's still gonna come. He's just behind those branches. If I move now, he is gonna run. There he goes. Huh. Cool. I'm gonna go forward slightly. Oh, come on. A roll would be good round about now. Now that is the much shyer, or usually much shyer. Oh, here you go. I just saw the tip of a tail disappearing. The typically much shyer cousin of the dwarf mongoose that we regularly see. He's going to... There he is. He is... Oh, I wish the glare wasn't quite so bad. I think you're a little bit too high, Jandre. I think that branch is just blocking you. And there's nothing I can do except wait. There, can you see him now? There. At the base of the tree. Awesome. And off he goes, scampering along. So completely solitary, unlike our dwarf mongoose, unless you're looking at a mating pair or a female with young. And they usually, the only thing that we see of them is a disappearing tail. Oh, and that, I think, is that. Well, that was very cool. That's definitely the first time that I've been here and had a slender mongoose actively come close to me, cross in front of the road in front of me, and be completely relaxed. I think our tortoise has lost his race, or else is cheating, because it's completely vanished now. Where'd it go? I think it's gone. Hiding in some shade, I imagine. Now, of course, being ectothermic, in other words, taking on temperatures from outside, not being able to properly control their body temperature internally. For a tortoise, a hot day like today can be a little bit dangerous, although they're quite good at coping with it. But they need to make sure that they do try and stay out of the blazing sun, because they don't have any way to actively cool themselves down. Alright, well, let's go all the way from the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains right across to Juma and see what's happening there.
Well, we've managed to catch up to the lions thanks to Herbie and Byron. I can only see three lionesses so far. That's only one there. The other two are off in front of us. I'm not sure where they're off to, but let's stick with them. And we've got two adult lionesses to our right. There she is walking. And they're in a really thick, difficult area. Henry, they're mobile north again towards vertical axis. So as you can see, tactical driving is needed, but we are amongst the lions. Who's that now? Does that look like Amber Eyes? You see her there. Let me just go forward a bit, maybe. There we go. She's looking quite a lot better if it is amber. I can't see whether it's got suckle marks or not. Now, they might have been out hunting. It sounds like they're calling for the cubs at the moment. Oh. Okay, it should be a little bit of an open gap through the next spot. We're just going to gap to get skinny, Eggsy, get skinny between the two silver cluster leaves. It's a good thing we're skinny, Eggs. So they're moving into a slightly nicer area to follow them. Here we go, right in front of us, about to pop out. Oh, they've got blood on, has she got blood on her face? Have they made a kill? Just zoom in on her chin there for me. Indeed, indeed she does. So they must have a kill here somewhere. Let's hope it's not a buffalo. You guys are allowed to eat anything except buffalo, preferably hippo. Get those fat content back. Of course it is probably a buffalo, but we'll find out shortly, hopefully, as they lead us either back to the cubs and then to the kill, or back to the kill. It's going to be interesting to find out which. And thankfully they've chosen a much nicer area. Now remember, this is 100% live. We're following a lion's through the African bush. And if you want to ask me any questions, you can do that by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or the email address questions@wildearth.tv. So I only saw blood on one of the lionesses. There we go. Hello, girls. And that is Amber Eyes on the left there. She is looking much better. The prides on a kill. It does happen where a lioness might grab something by herself, something like a kudu or a zebra or who knows what. There we go. Where are you off to? Yeah, definitely looks like Amber's walking much, much better. Let me look at her there. Now they've split. One lioness is heading further to the west, and these two are going east. Interesting. Maybe the one female is going to fetch the cubs, and the others are going back to the kill. Let's find out which. Jackie J, indeed, is saying we've reached another ridiculous milestone. It's 75 days in a row of big cats. No, I can't see where the third lioness is. She's gone off there. I think I'm going to stick with the two. There's still one lioness who might be crossing behind here somewhere. One's got blood on her face, so I think they might have made a kill. You got one? Oh, there's another one there. Let's go have a look. Let's get in there. There's the fourth lioness. I wonder if the cubs are here. Could these two be heading off to try and find the cubs, or are they leading us back to the kill? Here we go. So now we've got three out of the five. That the one lioness just woofed down all by herself. And they are going to now take us into possibly one of the most technical blocks where it comes to driving on the whole of Juma. Now, not because it's particularly steep or rocky or full of holes, just because it's really, really thick. So I'm gonna have to go quite slowly. Hopefully we'll be able to keep up with them. Do we ever see lions eating other predators? I haven't seen it here, Connor, but I have seen it in other places. I've seen lions eating lions. I've seen lions eating a leopard. I've seen lions eating a cheetah. But I've never seen them eating a hyena is the one thing I haven't seen them. I've seen them kill hyena. Ah, cubs. So this is where they left the cubs. Now we'll see if the kill's big enough to warrant the females fetching the cubs and taking them back towards where the other lioness went. Well, here's the last lioness. So we've seen all five, only four presently right here. And it doesn't look like there's a kill here. That I can see right now, and that doesn't mean that there isn't. Stations out there, I've got four Ansatis and some of the Mampimpans now in the block between Gallagher Shortcut and Aubrey's. So the lioness with the blood on her face is also here. Copy, thanks. Now there we go, you can see the blood on the chin. Now, as I said, it could have been something tiny like a Steenbok or something. That's why she's not leading the rest of the pride back, because it's already finished. Okay, let's do a quick cub count. I can see five immediately. One, two, three, four, five. There, that little one was looking quite bad the last time I spent a bit of time with the pride. Let's see what she's looking at now. Looking better. Definitely looking better. Hang on. One, two, three, four, five, six. There's still six. Okay, so exit zoom. And up a little bit. And there we can just see an ear through the bush. There's number six. So there's the little This one of the small ones, it was looking particularly bad a few days ago, definitely looking much better now. Nice shady peltiforum or weeping wattle. Oh, maybe they have eaten. Some of these cubs have got massive bellies. Maybe it was something small enough that they've finished it already. But it's good to see the pride looking a lot better than they have been for the last while. There's still one lioness behind us, or two actually, but one close, one quite far from us. Wait to see if these lions get up and start heading towards a potential carcass, or are they going to snooze in the shade of the peltiforum. Byron has found something that's quite difficult to see.
Look at the camouflage of this little spider, everybody. This is incredible. So well camouflaged. Now, I'm looking at these legs, and it's got these very light, hairy legs, these dark black hairs. Now, I wonder if that's not perhaps a mimic of sorts to mimic some of these hairy caterpillars to prevent birds from trying to hunt the spider. I'm not entirely sure, but it's a theory. But look at that, it looks very, very beautiful, and it does look, actually, if you look at those legs, they do look a little bit like a hairy caterpillar. And this little spider is so well camouflaged. I'm not sure what spider it is though. I've never seen one of these before. It just shows you how interesting it is being out on foot in the bush. You always find little insects and arachnids or anything interesting that a lot of the time you haven't seen before. Especially if you've worked out here for a long time, it's not uncommon to bump into little creatures which you haven't seen before. I'm gonna try to let this little guy go. Don't want to disturb it too much. There we go. And slowly back up. Yeah, there we go. Perfect. Lovely. Wasn't that great? Sure, it is very, very hot. Starting to sweat quite a bit. It was great to find those lions again on foot. I'm so glad Brent got to see them and he's spending time with them. Hopefully they look for some shade now and they settle down. We moved out of that area, so we didn't disturb them anymore. And we got one or two little growls from them. And again, that was just a case of them being, I think, now being pushed a little bit too far. And the lioness is trying to protect the cubs. So just a warning, just one or two growls, but they did still choose to move away from us. And Taylor apparently is watching and she says maybe it's a link spider. Link or link spider? And thanks, Taylor. I don't know. I've never seen one of those before. It is interesting. Links. Links. A link spider. That's interesting. So we will have to look that up. And let's see what else we can find. While Brent is trying to find out if those lions settle down or not, I'm trying to see if there are any more interesting little tracks around here. Some little grasshoppers flying about. It's always very, very difficult. That's a lovely stick, isn't it nice? My walking stick, my new walking stick. most trackers, when they walk, they generally walk with these sticks, tracking sticks they call them, so that as they walk they can circle little tracks and they can continue tracking, and if they lose the track they'll go back to the last track, or they'll sometimes just walk and draw a line in the sand, so as they're walking they'll just mark the tracks so that they know exactly where the tracks are going and they'll follow like that. Let's see what else we can find here. It's a lovely morning, but it is definitely getting much, much warmer. I think today is going to be a scorcher. Probably very, very hot later on. There's a lot of elephant damage. Just walking around, noticing, you can see there's a little stump that's been pushed over and broken over there too, and we saw it the other day with elephants feeding on the roots of trees. So there's a lot of damage around, and you do see it especially in the winter when it is so dry. But at the moment, with everything starting to become green and lush again, it starts to recover, and those trees and that eventually start either sprouting new leaves if their roots are still anchored. Otherwise, you see the greenery starts fading all of that out, which is quite nice. We're going to carry on and see what other little creatures we can find. Let's head back to Brenty's with the lions. Let's see what they're up to.
Now the whole pride is up and moving. The cubs are behind us. We're staying with the front three running lionesses. I'm pretty certain now they went back to the cubs to collect them, to take them to a kill. So we're going to stick with them. They're moving parallel to us, and we're just going very slowly through the bush. There they are. Fortunately, a little bit more open than where it was earlier. Where are you off to, lions? Nice big elephant path for us to follow. Now, some of you will remember this area. I think it was actually the last time I saw young Sindile. He had an impala kill right here. I wonder what they've caught. Oh, what's that going on there? I can see it looks like a lioness feeding. Hold on. The lioness who didn't come back to the cubs. Let's fingers crossed it's not a buffalo. Oh dear. It is a buffalo. Another buffalo. Is it? It is indeed a buffalo. Hopefully it's a fatty buffalo. Here we go. Our cubs should be here shortly. I'm just gonna sit here. Hello, girly. Andrew, if you've got my visual, there's a buffalo kill here. Here we go. There she is, getting stuck in. Look at all the flies already with this heat. This looks to be a youngish buffalo, hopefully a young, plump, very fatty buffalo. Eggs, watch out, those lions might come up behind you. No. So it looks like it was actually killed quite early last night. And they are hungry. They've eaten quite a bit of it already. Where are the rest of the lions at? I suddenly saw this lioness through the bush, and I could see she was pulling and tugging on something. I was hoping it was going to be a zebra, but and zebras have high fat counts. Or a hippo would be even better. Now, quite fresh, it's not ponging just yet. I'm just trying to see, waiting for the rest of the pride to catch up. We of course jumped ahead of them now when I spotted her, so we should be here exactly when everyone arrives, which would be quite exciting. course, lions are unable to sort of put two and two together. The fact that they're eating only buffalo is causing the problems in the pride. They're instinctual animals, so, and buffalo are easy to catch for a lot of meat. So in a lion's mind, that's why they go, oh, look at that. Oh, so many flies. Don't come near us, flies. Foof. Go away. Eggsy's doing a bit of a dance when the fly came near him. That's not a fly, that's a beetle. It's okay. Now, where are the rest of the lions? They should be arriving shortly. Now, this carcass is right out in the open. And she might be pulling it now. She's gonna try and maybe move it to the shade. Look how strong she is. Oh, look at that swarm of flies. I think she might need a bit more help in pulling that carcass into a shady area. Okay, so while we wait for the rest of the pride to arrive, let's go see what Jamie's got.
We have the tale of the little tortoise that can, hopefully, get up this hill. This poor, beautiful little leopard tortoise is faced with what is, when you are that size, a relatively impassable obstacle. And it has tried from all angles, you can see from the scuffs in the sand. This poor leopard tortoise is desperately, desperately trying to cross the road and get up this embankment. And come on, come on, nearly, 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 nearly. Oh, so close. Come on. You've got the right place. Oh. Come on, little tortoise. Come on. Don't give up. Or maybe give up and go about 10 meters, a little bit further to the west of you, and you'll be fine. Come on, you can do it. Almost. Almost. I really want to go and help it. I can see its little feet digging into the sand, but the sand's so soft it keeps crumbling under. Oh no! Underneath its weight. And things are difficult when you're that height and that size, because you don't have the perspective of knowing exactly where it is you might be able to cross. Some instinct, or perhaps the scent of fresh flowers or something, is driving it that way. Oh, slipping on the sand dunes. Come on, little leopard tortoise. Oh, that's going to be even harder. No, that's not going to work. It's not going to work. Oh dear. Oh, you can see some legs stretching. Yay! Well done, little leopard tortoise. Oh no, now there's a massive stick in your way. You're just gonna bulldoze through it. Yep. Oh, this is a tortoise with a place to be. Sticks don't matter. It's just gonna keep going. I love tortoises. They are just inherently entertaining. Well done, buddy. Beautiful, shiny leopard tortoise. Probably a couple of years old. They do grow relatively slowly, so this one could be, if I had to guess, 5 or 6, maybe even slightly older. I'm no expert at aging tortoises. Look at him marching. I'm glad that we could all share in the trials and victory of this particular leopard tortoise that could. In the meantime, let's go back across to Brent and his lions.
Well, we're still there. The rest of the pride's actually obviously been feeding already, and they're lying up about 15 to 20 meters behind us. Oh. And it sounds like Mike is behind us. He can see her. It seems like she's going back to call the cubs. They might have got tired and stopped. Copy, Mike. I think she's probably just, the cubs have probably got tired on their way and they've stopped. She's probably just going to fetch them. It's incredible the amount of flies that are inside this carcass. That is absolutely crazy. Every time she starts feeding, it's just this swarm. Now, Tracy in New York's asked her, interesting question, where do the maggots and the flies come from? Well, Tracy, that's sort of where, who came first, the chicken or the egg, because it's the same principle. The flies lay their eggs and the eggs become maggots and then they pupate and then become flies. And there's many thousands of different indigenous fly species to Africa. So, that it is natural, they are there to help dispose of rotting flesh and that, and the maggots provide a very important ecological role because they also, well, apart from disposing of living flesh, they provide a very important food source for other animals. So it sounds like the rest of the pride are just steeping up in the shade. Now, Maggie is wondering, can the flies cause any diseases or problems for the lions? There are probably a few fly-borne diseases that might affect lions. Not any that I know of in this area particularly. Look at those swarms and swarms of flies. Now, as it gets warmer and warmer in summer, we're going to see more and more of these around carcasses. Now, a lot of the fly species here breed with the rain. So if you get rain and then a very hot day, your fly population explodes. Herbie, I'll talk to you just now. Okay, look at this. And she's really getting stuck in. She's really looking hungry because it's really hot and she's still feeding. The rest of the pride, I said they were looking quite full. Maybe they've already eaten their fill. They might have got a little fright when Byron and Herbie found them and ran off a little bit, and that's why the cubs weren't here, because it definitely looks like they've been fed on. It's been fed on extensively. The other option is now, because it sounds like those three females and the cubs are up and moving to the east, they might be heading towards the Galago Pan for a drink. The grass grows and the rains keep coming, and the buffalo should improve in condition. And Kyle is wondering, will that cause the lion's success rate in hunting buffalo to drop? Generally it does. So what happens is, during the winter months, lions always have a better success rate with buffalo in the dry season, and in the wet season not really. But what's interesting here is that these buffalo still haven't recovered from that drought, so they are still feeling the effects of the drought. I think it's going to be a few months yet before they recover fully. Just to give you an idea of how many flies are actually around here, I mean, you can see all of the ones buzzing around her face and in the carcass. But if we come out, eggs, and we start right next to you, you can if you want, but all the little trees surrounding us, look at that. Flies, flies, flies. Now those are the ones that have probably laid their eggs already. And you don't really want to touch any of these bushes. All of the bushes around here are literally littered with flies. You can see how they're sitting on the underside of the branch in the shade. What are you up to, madam? You're just changing feeding positions. There we go. You can see every little branch around here covered in flies. Fortunately, they haven't decided we're good for landing on just yet. Hello, Nicole, who's in Canada. Nicole is wondering, what is the white stuff that she keeps pulling there? Is it the muscles? No, the muscles will be red. It's sinew. It's sinew, Nicole. Sinew and ligaments and tendons, those are the white things. Standing by, Henry. I copy. Thanks, Henry. No problem. Look forward to your next visit. Sorry, just saying goodbye to Henry from Buffalo's Hook, who's heading home. He's just thanking us for help over the last few days. And that's what we do, and that's why you hear us talking on the Game Drive channel. We all help each other to find the best sightings possible that we can all enjoy. Oh, flies, 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 flies. I don't know how much longer I'm going to stay right here, because I think if we sit here for too long, the flies might think we're a good spot to sit. But we will stay for a little bit longer, but while we wait to see if the rest of the pride decides to come join, let's go back to Byron, who's got more flies.
We do indeed have more flies. Just thought it'd be interesting to come have a look, and unfortunately most of the insects we wanted to show you have flown away already. Now we're at the little waterhole at Vuyatela or Gallagher waterhole, and there are a lot of flies that have come down to drink, but there were some butterflies around here too, common vagrants, and then one or two wasps that also came down to drink, but they unfortunately have flown away. Oh, there's a beautiful butterfly on the other side. I wonder if it will stay there. So the problem is you walk up quite close to them, and then can I give you a hand there, Vim? Can you stand up? Let's see, maybe we can have a look there. There we go, look at that beautiful butterfly. Wow, orange and black. I have absolutely no idea what butterfly that is. Lesser spotted orange and black, I think that's its name. I'm just joking, everyone. I'm not sure what it is. But it sounds like most of the butterfly names. You get the broad bordered grass yellows, and you get some very, very interesting citrus swallowtails. So that's maybe a lesser spotted orange and black. Still around there. I'm gonna just fly off now again, yeah. So it's interesting to come past these little water holes, especially now with it starting to warm up quite a lot of insects coming down and drinking. But at the moment it's mainly the flies, the odd butterfly still whizzing past and coming down for water and then flying off again. Sure, it's really getting very, very hot now. I was hoping we'd find some animals down here drinking, but it doesn't look like anything has come through here recently, and don't see any sign of any animals around. It's always nice to just lift the rock up, maybe we get lucky in something. No, just a few termites. Put their house back. There's a crested barbet calling in the corner in the distance, and then there's another one. It sounded like it was coming from this large tree, but I can't see it. Might just be the echo from that one behind us calling, but it did sound like there were two of them. Now there's definitely one over here somewhere that is calling. Beautiful crested barbet, that red and black bird with yellow, and it's got beautiful, beautiful colors. There it is. Just to the left-hand side of the tree, and then it's flying. Can you see it there? There we go. I heard it calling here. It's just in the shade there at the moment, unfortunately, but it may move again. There we go. Look at that beautiful yellow, black. Look at that crest as it calls. Wonderful. The crested barbet. So that is replying to its friend. I think it's calling behind us. Ah, that is wonderful, wonderful. All right, let's head over to Jamie again and see what she is up to and where she is. I actually don't know.
I thought we were going to finish off with quite an unusual sighting of a tree agama right in the middle of the road in the sun, but unfortunately they don't stay. There we go. How awesome is that? What a cool way to end off a morning full of really interesting and relatively unusual sights. Including this little tree agama that is sitting in the sun. Sorry, give me 1 second. You can come past, Peter, if you want. You can come past if you want. Yeah, it's fine. No stress. Hopefully he sticks. He's pretty cool. He went behind that tree. Bear with me one moment, I will show you. I will show you where he is. Hi, Chris. This is the coolest tree agama sighting ever. Bright blue head. I'm just going to move out of the way so I don't have to repeat this process. Your guests haven't lost a hat, have they?
No. Okay.
Thank you. I think, yeah, I'm hoping it isn't claimed. Look at the incredible shimmer on these scales. Really, truly incredible colour. Turquoise. Much like the colour of the lilac-breasted roller. So this is a male. The females are much more drab in colour. They don't tend to be quite so, what's the word? Look at the hole around the ear. They don't have external ears. Well, they do. They have external ears, but they don't have ears in the way that we do, or elephants, or lions, or leopards do. They just have straight-up openings into the ear canal. Look at him go! This has been the strangest day for me. Slender mongoose, agama. Hot, 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 hot. Just imagine it. Hot, 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 hot. Hot, hot, hot. And phew, up the tree. Well done, Chandra. Awesome. and our triagama returning to its more natural position, hidden away on the bark of a tree. Now, it's not often that we get to see them on the ground. They can, of course, move about over the surface of the land, but they much prefer to be hidden in trees where there's the ever-ready hiding hole. Oh, this is Tundi's tree, actually. This is where Tundi had her impala, the one that was described as the world's most morbid wind chime when she left the rest of the impala carcass. There is our tree agama. Thank you for that. It's been such a strange morning between the agama and the... You're right there, Jean-André. Between the agama and the... and the slender mongoose and the tortoise. It's just been one of those things. Really is stunning looking in the sun. I came across a paper the other day, and I haven't read it fully, about the way in which tree agamas choose the tree that they live in. And when I finished reading it, it's really hot. I will get back to you on exactly what it was that was said and studied, and how they go about selecting their appropriate tree to choose as their home. You'll see that I've kept the hat for now. I have desperately tried to track down the owner. I've called it in on 3 different radio channels, and nobody is responding. And Dana, you want to know at what age a safari hat will leave its parents. Well, Dana, to be honest, a safari hat very much depends on the species of the safari hat, because, you know, different animals leave at different times, and so do different safari hats. So, for example, a hat such as this, without this cord, so the species of safari hat without this cord, leaves its parents at a very early age, a very young age, particularly at high speeds. A cap is somewhere in the middle. And a hat with a drawstring like this, it's actually relatively unusual to actually find it in its independent stage at all. So we've actually been very, very lucky with all of our exceptional sightings. And on that completely mad note, a big thank you to Jean-André for his wonderful camera work, as well as to all of you for your questions and your comments. We're looking forward to seeing you on the Sunset Safari. Bye-bye, everybody.
Now the rest of the pride are lying up somewhere in the shade close by. This is obviously a hungry girl, and it's one of the mothers, and she's just really getting stuck in there. She's probably trying to utilize the last of the semi-cool morning and to feed off that buffalo. She's tried to drag it a few times, but there's so little shade around, and I think by herself it's just a little bit too big. Now I'm quite sure that she'll lie up close by once she's sated herself and keep the vultures at bay, and I'm sure the rest of the pride are going to join her at some point. They probably ate better early this morning. And it's really great to see the Nkumas looking quite a lot better, although they're naughty eating buffalo. Hopefully they ate a warthog in between and some nice bacon. But they are looking better, and the buffalo should be picking up condition, so they should be able to get fat from the buffalo and able to ingest or break down the vitamin E into useful parts. Well, we can only hope, but it is definitely looking a lot better than it was a week or so ago. And of course, this is a new carcass. This is not the one they killed and abandoned. Now, from the last 2 buffalo that they've actually eaten through and through, they seem to be younger animals. Maybe they've got a little bit, we're hoping they've got a little bit of a higher fat count. And one positive about her dragging the buffalo a little bit further away from us, there's less flies buzzing on top of us, which is always a good thing. Now, Kevin. Kevin wants to know what it smells like. Well, Kevin, it actually doesn't smell too bad. This is quite a fresh kill. If we look next to us here, eggs right down. You can actually see there's a couple of dung beetles inside. That's what the stomach content. And it just smells like undigested grass. So almost like fresh cut grass, just a little bit different, add a bit of stomach juice. So not an unpleasant smell at all, but I think with this heat that we're having today, by the end of today, it's gonna be really smelly and definitely putrid by tomorrow, but they are making a very short work of it. But it has been absolutely splendid having you on this sunrise safari, and I managed not to fight with any caterpillars today, and hopefully not to fight with any caterpillars for the rest of the year and next year and the year after that and the year after that. After then, maybe I can fight with one caterpillar. But remember, we're going to be here on the sunset safari. We've got Inkahumas on a buffalo kill. Karula's killed in Inyala. Hopefully she'll be back there with Shungile and Hosana, and maybe some elephants will turn up as well. We never know. That's the joy of the live safaris. But for the last couple of seconds, I'm going to keep talking, but have a look at the incredible Inkahuma, who's munching on her buffalo. As I said, it's going to be a cat-filled sunset safari, an amazing 75 days of big cats. So from Eggsy, myself, and the whole Safari Live crew, we'll see you in a few short hours.